In this module, we'll learn about the Zeeman effect in atomic spectroscopy. So we'll first discuss the learning outcomes of this module, give a brief introduction, again go back to spin orbit coupling, the Zeeman effect, and what are the selection rules. We shall learn about the quantitative aspects of spin orbit coupling and how to recognize Russell-Saunders coupling in an atom. You are aware that for smaller atoms, the Russell-Saunders coupling scheme applies, but for the heavier elements, it is the JJ coupling that applies. There are some intermediate elements where we do not know where the Russell-Saunders coupling is applied or the JJ coupling. So this is what we learn in this module, and then we will discuss the Zeeman effect, which gives rise to additional splitting of lines in a magnetic field. The splitting of lines in the presence of a magnetic field is called the Zeeman effect. We've come across this effect before also, and this important effect helps in the assignment of transitions. Historically, Zeeman observed that each line in a transition is split into three lines. Later observations splitting into many more lines, and this came to be known as the anomalous Zeeman effect, and the splitting into three lines was called the normal Zeeman effect because this is what was observed previously. But later on, we came to know that the so-called anomalous Zeeman effect is actually the rule, and this is what applies everywhere. And normal Zeeman effect, what was called the normal Zeeman effect, is a special case for only singlet states. So we first begin with the discussion of the quantitative aspects of Russell-Saunders coupling. Now coming to spin orbit coupling, the term symbol, as you know, is 2s plus 1, which gives the multiplicity, L gives the total orbital angular momentum, and J gives the total angular momentum. It emphasizes the fact that in Russell-Saunders coupling, the energy depends on three quantum numbers, that is S, L and J. The Hamiltonian for spin orbit coupling is given by H. The Hamiltonian is a scalar multiple A, which is a constant, multiplied by the dot product of the vector quantities, the total angular momentum vector L and dot S. And A is called the spin orbit coupling constant. So this is the additional energy term which comes in the atom due to spin orbit coupling. Now we also know that J is equal to L plus S because it is the total angular momentum, and we can do some mathematics to show that the LS is equal to half into J square, the vector J square minus L square minus S square, and this means that the spin orbit Hamiltonian, when it applies to its eigenfunction, it gives you the value of A, L dot S, and the wave function back again, and this is given by A by 2 J square minus L square minus S square, the magnitude of all these into the wave function, and this means that the spin orbit interaction energy is given by the interaction energy E int is equal to A by 2 J into J plus 1 minus L into L plus 1 minus S into S plus 1 all multiplied by H cross square, because the eigenfunctions of the J square operator are J into J plus 1. So the energy of the term depends upon the values of LS and J. Now if you want to find out the energy separation between two different values of J, this can be easily found by finding out the energy of the J plus 1 level minus the energy of the Jth level, and this is given by A into H cross square J plus 1. Now this is called the Lande interval rule, and it states that the separation between two adjacent levels within a term is proportional to the larger of the two J values involved. So since this was a transition from J to J plus 1, J plus 1 is the larger value, and that is why the interaction energy is equal to A into H cross square J plus 1. And this can be used to determine the value of J from which the transition occurred, and also to determine whether the Russell-Saunders coupling scheme is valid in this particular case. Now we'll consider the carbon 2p2 configuration, and we have already seen that it gives rise to a 3p ground state. Now for this state, as you can see, L is equal to 1 because it is a p state, and S is also equal to 1 because this is a triplet state. Now when you substitute in this equation, what you find is that the interaction energy is equal to A H cross square by 2 J into J plus 1 minus 2 minus 2. These two terms have come from L into L plus 1 and S into S plus 1. So you have three different J values. J is equal to 2. In that case, the energy delta E function of H cross square is equal to A. For J is equal to 1, the energy is equal to minus A. And for J is equal to 0, the energy is equal to minus 2. And you can see that J is equal to 0 is the ground state. And this is what we have shown in this diagram. Experimentally, the energy gap between adjacent J values is normally between 50 to 800 centimeter inverse. It is small and it is much less than the spacing between the main spectroscopic terms, which is of the order of 10,000 centimeter inverse. For carbon, the separation between 3p0 and 3p1 is only 16.4 centimeter inverse, and between 3p0 and 3p2 it is 43.5 centimeter inverse, and you can see from the figure. And according to the Landes interval rule, the separation between 3p2 and 3p1 and 3p1 and 3p0 should be in the ratio 2:1 J plus 1 values, which is approximately obeyed. That means that carbon does not strictly obey the Russell-Saunders coupling scheme. Now, the spin orbit coupling constant is different for different terms and can be of either sign. It can be positive, it can be negative. That now we already know that for oxygen, the order of energy levels is different from that of carbon, and this means that A is greater than 0 for less than half filled orbitals, because that is why the lowest energy level is minus 2A and then you have minus A and plus A. And it is negative for more than half filled subshells, because the energy order level gets reversed in these, and this is according to Hund's third rule. Now for oxygen, it has a 2p4 electronic configuration and the same 3p ground state as carbon, but the spacing between 3p2 and 3p1, here 3p2 is lower in energy and 3p1 terms is 158 centimeter inverse, and that between 3p2 and 3p0 is 227 centimeter inverse. Now the ratio of the spacings between 3p2 and 3p1 and 3p1 and 3p0 is 2.29. So again, it is close to the expected value of 2, but not exactly 2. Then the amount of splitting increases as the number of electrons, and electron repulsion because of the number of electrons increases, and energy order is also reverse. Now 3p2 is lower in energy since the spin orbit coupling constant is negative for more than half filled states. So in the figure we have shown that in the orbital model there are 15 states which have the same energy. And due to electrostatic interaction, that is orbit-orbit exchange and so on, it is split into three levels. 3p is the lowest of all the energy levels, then you have 1d and then you have 1s. Now due to spin-orbit interaction, you have the 3p level splitting into three levels for different values of J. 3p0 is lowest in energy, 3p1 and then 3p2. And similarly, the 1D level, it is split into only a single level, 1D2, because of spin orbit interaction, because it is a singlet state. The same is there for the 1S state, which only has one possible term, and that is 1S0. Now, in the presence of a magnetic field, all of these are split into different energy levels. The 3P0 level is split in only to one energy level, because 2J plus 1 is equal to 1. For 3p1, the 2j plus 1 value is equal to 2 into 1 plus 1, and this is what happens. It is split into three states and these have mj values, minus 1, 0 and 1. For the 3p2 level, there are 5 states and these are in order of increasing energy, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1 and 2. And similarly for 1d2, there are minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1 and 2. Now, Ej value is associated with 2j plus 1 values of mj, which are degenerate in the presence of an external magnetic or electric field. Now, when an external magnetic field is applied, you have the Zeeman effect, and this is what we are going to discuss now. So, we've seen that each atom is like a tiny magnet whose magnetic moment is proportional to the magnitude of the angular momentum. That is, the magnetic moment due to J, which we'll call as mu J, is equal to minus E h cross as you know is Planck's constant divided by 2 pi, divided by 2 mass of the electron, and then you have Gj. Gj is a constant which gives the degeneracy of a level, into square root of J into J plus 1, and this is generally written as minus beta Gj into Mj, and beta is equal to minus Eh cross 2me. It is a combination of fundamental constants, so we can find out its value. It is called the Bohr magneton, and its magnitude is 9.274000968 × 10⁻²⁴ joule per Tesla. The magnetic field is measured in a unit called Tesla, and when J is equal to 0, you see that the atom is diamagnetic because mu J is also equal to 0, and when J is not equal to 0, it is paramagnetic. The Landé G factor is also given by a combination of J, S and L quantum numbers, and Gj is equal to 1 plus, then you have this fraction J into J plus 1 plus S into S plus 1 minus L into L plus 1, 2J into J plus 1 is in the denominator. So we already know that there are 2J plus 1 values of Mj associated with Ej. Before a magnetic field is applied, all directions are equal. There is no preferred direction. And the moment a magnetic field is applied, what happens? The direction, one of the direction becomes unique. That is the direction of the magnetic field. And the magnetic moment of the atom may be either aligned with the field or against it. The component of the magnetic moment in the direction of the field, the field is given by a symbol B. It is a vector quantity. It is given by mu in the presence of a magnetic field is equal to minus Eh cross by 2me, and C is the speed of light, Gj into Mj. The perturbation due to the magnetic field is thus, this is what has happened to the energy, the new Hamiltonian, the perturbation Hamiltonian, H prime is equal to minus mu B and multiplied by B. These are vector quantities, it is a dot product. And if you find out the interaction energy, that is given by beta into Gj into Mj into B. So we find that the interaction energy is proportional to the strength of the magnetic field B and the value of Mj. More negative values of Mj are therefore lower in energy, and this is what we had shown in the figure. Minus 2 was lower in energy compared to minus 1, 0, 1 and 2 for a J value of 2. So once we have split the energy levels into different Mj values, we need to note the new selection rules that come into force because of the splitting of lines. So the selection rules we already know for J, L and S are delta J has to be 0 or plus minus 1. And but remember that J is equal to 0 to 0 transition is not allowed. Delta L is equal to plus or minus 1 and delta S is equal to 0. So when you apply a magnetic field, there is a splitting into different Mj values, and the new selection rule that is there is delta Mj is equal to 0 or plus minus 1, but again delta Mj cannot be 0 if delta J is also 0. Again, this is due to the requirement of the conservation of angular momentum. The photon that is absorbed or emitted must change the angular momentum by one unit. So either it should change the total angular momentum or one of its components, that is Mj, and because the photon is getting absorbed and it has its own angular momentum of one unit. Now this additional selection rule causes a splitting of lines in a magnetic field, and this is what is the Zeeman effect. In an electric field, we know that this is called the Stark effect because it was first observed by the scientist Stark. So we'll take an example. Consider the 1s0 to 1p1 transition for sodium in the presence and absence of a magnetic field. This is an allowed transition having delta J is equal to 1, delta L is equal to 1 and delta S is equal to 0. And this is the transition that you will see in the absence of a magnetic field. And there will be only one line. But when you apply an external magnetic field, it is split into three lines due to the Zeeman effect. The splitting of lines into three was first observed by Zeeman, and this is called the normal Zeeman effect. Now this, because what has happened is you have three different values of Mj for the 1p1 state, so each transition will be split into three, and this was what was observed by Zeeman. And but later on it was shown by other scientists that this is a special case for singlet states. In other cases you will find more than the three lines, and this is actually the general rule, but because Zeeman first observed the splitting into three lines, that was called the normal Zeeman effect. And here in the figure we have shown the 1s0 to 1p1 transition, and you can see that it is split into three lines and due to the Zeeman effect, and all the three transitions are allowed because delta j is not equal to 0. Now let us consider the 3s to 3p transition in sodium. The 3s1 configuration gives rise to the term 3 2s half, we have already seen that. The excited 3p1 configuration gives you 2 j values, that means you have two states, 2p half and 2p3/2, of which the former is lower in energy, 2p half is lower in energy because it is less than half filled. Now in the absence of a magnetic field, only two lines are observed, and these are the D lines that you are already familiar with. In the presence of a magnetic field, what will happen, that this particular transition, instead of two lines you observe 10. Now there are a possibility of 12 lines is there, but only 2 mj = -3/2 to plus half and mj = +3/2 × -half, they are forbidden because delta mj is not equal to ±1, it is equal to ±2. So you find these 10 lines which are shown in the figure shows the splitting of the sodium D lines in the presence of a magnetic field. So you see this is the normal rule, but when it becomes a singlet state, because J then is equal to L, you will find that in those particular cases you will find only three lines occurring. So we have learned here why there is a splitting of lines due to the Zeeman effect, because of the splitting into different MJ levels, and how these transitions are how the splitting occurs when it is not a singlet state. So finally we'll summarize. The electrostatic interactions split an electron configuration into states of different energy. Spin orbit coupling further splits these terms into different J values. Now each J value is associated with 2J plus 1 values, and these are degenerate in the absence of an external field. In the presence of a magnetic field, each of these J levels is split into 2J plus 1 levels, leading to splitting of lines, and this is known as the Zeeman effect.